It is our great honor, as you'll hear later, to be in co-partnership with the Nelson Mandela Foundation and with Graça Machel. The way the program will work once the President of Chile has arrived is like this. I will greet everybody. The Vice Chancellor of the university will welcome and greet Mama Shell. She then will welcome and greet Her Excellency, the President of Chile. Yaliwe Clark is then going to take over in terms of facilitation. We're expecting Her Excellency to speak for about 10 minutes and to be responded to for a short space of time by Nomonisa Gaza, who, as you will all know, is a very well-known feminist within African and Pan-African debates. We will then be opening things up to you for commentary, for input. We're going to get two small podia here, and we would, as soon as they come in, we can't bring in the podium before everybody's seated. And we're going to invite, Yaliwe will invite you to stand at the podium. It makes it a bit easier because this is live streaming. Otherwise, we would have a roving mic, but for live streaming, it's a bit easier if people are brave enough to get up and stand at podia. And who am I saying brave enough to? You. Okay. All right. Please come and stand at podia for comments, for input. We won't have that much time, but we hope that you will be able to use the time we do have. We'll then go back to two panelists, Zetu Matabeni and Mwiselo Buerta, who will give their points of view as panelists. Yaliwe will tell you more about them. Some of you will know them already. And then we'll have another patch for the audience to do the same thing. So we've made it as dialogue-y as possible within the constraints of a large hall and a complicated set of issues. And we hope very much that you will be willing to take advantage of those opportunities. What we're going to do now is move into a pre-program. We will have to stop it as soon as we get the information that President Bachelet is on her way. But we're going to start with this.
There are many people who feel that it is useless and futile for us to continue talking peace and non-violence against a government whose reply is only savage attacks on an unarmed and defenseless people.
Okay, morning everyone. We thought we'll start with a feisty African woman, Brenda Fassie, and remember some of her powerful words and also her powerful life and also a celebration. I think it's not an accident that we're here invited by the Nelson Mandela Foundation, hosted by Gracia Michelle. And yes, an important occasion, lots of important things to discuss. So in our pre-program, we thought, okay, let's get into a space where we can begin to raise some of the questions, the concerns, the issues we would like to be spoken, perhaps addressed through speaking, right? Because sometimes when we speak issues, they get addressed. Sometimes not. But let's have a very important conversation, and let's reflect on how we can pull out and tease out very important issues around gender equality, around the possibility for gender justice, around what it means for substantive, I would call, peace and contentment, and yet robust creativity, an alternative to what we have currently in society. So we're going to have a couple of clips. Like Jane said, we've got a number of organizations present here that have been doing important work. And we thought one of the ways to stimulate conversation is to show a couple of more clips, right? Just a few minutes clips, and we open up to the floor. And this is clips of work that's being done. It's also clips that depict some of the issues that we know are significant to what it means to make gender justice possible. So we have a short clip. We're not going to show the whole film, and it's a piece of work that's been done by Gender Sonke Gender Justice, and they've been working a lot with questions of masculinities and violence and also aspects of fatherhood, very aware that this is one angle to the issue, right? So just a few minutes of that clip, and then let's look at what's there, what's not there, and then get into a short conversation. So can we have that clip?
My mother is a domestic worker. It was not easy to raise us. It was a tough game for her. My father was not available at all. Like, it's a ghost. My brother Andrew now is expecting his first child.
I'm gonna need his help with the baby. I'm gonna need him to be more understanding and to be more hands-on.
There are things that I'm nervous about. What kind of a father am I going to be? Well, I'm worried that my brother Andrew might not be responsible enough. I want him to be there. Kailicha is a huge township outside Cape Town. It's like we climbed in a situation whereby we can't breathe, you see. We have a lot of criminals, we have a lot of gangsters. When you grow up in that kind of situation whereby boys are learning all these bad stories about men, they think actually that to be a man is like that. The biggest worry is when they're repeating of the same thing to generation to generation. My father, he failed me. I don't think he realizes the dent that he created in my life. But it's not about that. It's not about your past. It's about your future. To be a good dad is not just about money. It's about your availability. There is that kind of like closeness, connectivity. When I'm around them, I feel like everything is in place.
Okay, so that's actually an 8-minute video. We just went in about 3 or 4 minutes. So it sets sort of a scene, gets us into sort of a backdrop of some of the issues, the context here in Cape Town. So the areas, the places people live, what it means to consider manhoods and violence and present or absent parenthood, in this case, fatherhood. Okay? So I know you came with your own issues. Never mind what's on film, right? But, so you can, you know, I'm inviting conversation. You know, you probably came with some of your own issues. There may be something in this clip that brings something up for you. And I'm very keen to hear from you. So let's start a conversation. We've got 2 mics in the aisle, so you're welcome to just walk straight to the mile. You don't need to wait to the aisle. You don't need to wait to be identified and walk to a mic. Or you can raise your hand and a mic will be brought to you. Who would like to go first? Yes, please. You can step in the aisle. There's a mic in the aisle right next to you, fortunately. Fantastic.
Hi, I'm Andy Kawa.
Yes.
I'm going to respond to the clip.
Sure.
I think that it is important when we depict rape and gender-based violence to actually show the effect of it in the diversity of South Africa.
Yes.
Because I think that rape has no race, has no color, has no social class. That's one thing. The other thing is that we always talk about the statistic of 1 in 3 women will be raped in their lifetime. And silently, there's another statistic of 1 in 6 boys are being raped. But we never really dwell on that.
Mm.
And I think that it is very important for us to start to uplift that conversation, because it needs us to interrogate the sexual, the violence that we find in our men, because they are also raped and sodomized when they are young, and those young boys become men.
Mm. 2 very significant points. So we need to also look at the way in which violence is depicted and tends to be depicted in a racialized, you know, like there's certain racial categories that are necessarily experiencing more violence or are more violent, and we need to be wary of that. You know, how that portrayal is done, and also statistics around boyhood and violence. I think it's something that we're beginning to pay attention to and understand. And I think some of the work of Sonke Gender Justice begins to have that conversation. So questions of masculinities as well as femininities in conversation is significant for us to think creatively, right? I like the statistics. Thank you very much. Anyone else? You need not give stats, eh? Just your views. What's your point of view? Yes, please. Thank you. Go ahead.
My name is Ken. Technological sabotage. My name is Sakel Mwamba. I'm the national speaker of the SRC of UNISA. The issue which I want to raise, there's a point which I normally qualify it as rural crime or underdeveloped crime, which in context of policing in South Africa, we call it contact crime and all of that. Now, my belief is that if we can modernize all the areas, particularly in South Africa, if you develop them, the crime which is going to happen in those areas will definitely change. A person who commits crime in a rural area, they normally commit it differently in an urban area. Like when you are told of, if you know the scam of cats cloning, the same thug whom in a township will show you a knife when they want to take your wallet, if they find you at Sea Point, they will not do the same thing, but they will try another way of doing the very same thing, taking the same money from you, but in a modest way, without you having the physical contact. Now, this therefore means that if we are able to develop our underdeveloped areas, not that we'll be addressing crime, but we'll be addressing contact crime, because the issue of direct crime in terms of physical, it will not happen. And when you, even when you look at that very same video, when you go to Khayelitsha, you look the type of crime which is happening there, and you go to Sea Point and you look the type of crime which is happening there. There's crime in both areas, but it's not done by the same, but it can be done by one person. But the environment dictates that the type of crime you're going to do there will not be of slaughtering people and all of that. And this is what I depict from that video as well. Thanks.
So that's a point around infrastructure, cities, and we know the history of the way cities have been built, particularly Cape Town. The spread of facilities, services, livelihood options sets up a scene, a possibility for a way of interaction that can reinforce certain kinds of violence and create the possibility of those violences occurring. Masculinities being an expression, certain forms of masculinities being an expression. I'm seeing your hand, Yvette, and I just noticed we had two of our speakers walk into the room as the last person was upcoming speaker. So I just want to acknowledge the presence of the speakers who will speak later in the official program. We have Zetu Matubini, who is sitting in the second row, being very, very studious. And we have Nomboniso Gaza, welcome, and Buiselo Bota, welcome very much. Thank you so much for coming. We're having a pre-program session. The official program will follow at 11. Great. So looking at cities and the way cities are built. Would you like to see another clip from a totally different angle, just to move the conversation along? I see a hand. Could you wait until after the next clip? And I see your hand. And I see your hand. So we've got three hands upcoming and a fourth one there. My colleagues will help me remember you. And let's have the next clip. 3 minutes in. About 3 minutes, 30 seconds into the next clip.
Bible. It's abomination.
It's un-African.
If my son came to me and said, "Dad, I'm gay," I kill him.
Just because I'm a lesbian doesn't mean that I'm not a woman. I'm a woman firstly, and then comes being a lesbian. Who I'm sleeping with at any time, it doesn't matter. It doesn't even involve them. I'm not in a closet. I'm not hiding myself. I am a lesbian, and I'll always be a lesbian. You can rape me today, but still, I will still remain as a lesbian.
When I was stabbed, and even when I was raped, when I went to the police station, it was like something was wrong with me. We can't continue having a society where police, they become very selective what they have to do.
Tomorrow is the last day for Zolisha's case. It's been postponed more than 40 times. She was killed in 2006, and I mean, so tomorrow is the last day. We don't know what's going to happen. Maybe these guys will be out. We're going to be there, you know, show people that, you know, we are here. You know, we're still out as lesbians. We cannot change because some people don't like us.
Now four of them was going to be going down for murder. At least we didn't come here for nothing, you know.
Four
4 years ago when we started coming here. More than a year after Zuliso was brutally attacked and murdered, there must have been about 20 people that were standing here. And today when I see this, it fills me with pride. Because if it wasn't for this, that wouldn't have happened inside there.
She was never involved in some of the stuff. She was just playing soccer. She was just playing soccer and having fun. But she managed to motivate the other people. They know Zolisa now through those activists. All those 5 years, she was helping us to fight. I think now she just needs to rest in peace.
That's also just 3 minutes into, I think it's about 10 to 15 minutes film that you can find on YouTube. And it's made around Africa Pride. So some of the Pride marches we've been having and the issues that have been raised. And an organization that is present here, Free Gender, also you might see their work reflected in this clip. Great. So we had four hands before we showed the clip. I see there was a hand here. Would you like to come to the mic? And I will have a chance to get another set of questions. There were two hands there. And could we have a mic going to the lady who is on the other side of the building? Am I left and right? It's too complex for me to remember at the moment. Yes, go ahead.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you for the chance. I'm actually appealing for inclusivity because my observation has been that whenever people talk gender, they actually talk women. My name is Busiso. I'm coming from an organization called Gender Dynamics, and we advocate for the rights of transgender people. We have a group of people called transgender women, and those women are women who were born in male bodies. And their bodies are so non-conforming, and therefore they are punished daily by society. And so I'm appealing to the House, to the activists, academics, and all the people working in the gender sector. Whenever they conceptualize or think of their programs or their work, they need to know that there are still women who are seriously marginalized, and I therefore request the House to consider how they can include them in their work. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Sibusiso. Great. So there was two hands here. You want to go to the podium? And Yvette, you can come after. You're fine, right. So I know some names are not others, but just make eye contact, raise your hand, and you'll be able to speak.
Morning, everyone. I'm Nodlanda, a UCT student. I just want to comment on both videos. Firstly, I think the biggest problem with South Africa is the lack of education, not just education, but the quality of education. I think the only way that we can move forward as a country is only if we get quality education. When I go back home, I live in Durban, when I go back home to the townships, you can see that, yes, I am fortunate and privileged to come to an institute like UCT, but my fellow people that I grew up with, they don't have the same opportunities that I've had. And I think only once we've reached that stage will we see that my gender shouldn't matter, my race shouldn't matter, my homosexuality shouldn't matter. And it's something that we all have to work on. Not just the government, we shouldn't leave everything on the government because there's only so much they can do. As with my friends as well, even the conversations that I have with them, it's something that we should all work on because we are the future leaders, and it's something that we definitely need to work on because it's finally time for South Africa to get out of the mentality that we are not educated South Africans. Yeah. That's my
comment. So education, key factor, and what type of education? And where is it available? And who accesses it? Really important to think about. You know, in our gender studies classes, and you know, students come up to us, ask us, it's like, prof. And I'm like, no, not prof. It's Yaliwe. Prof Yaliwe, why didn't I learn this, you know, in grade 10? I'm like, I don't know, you know, I don't know why you didn't learn it in grade 10, but you were learning something, and something about what you were learning reinforced something problematic, you know, and that's why you've only come to, we've come to this realization in tertiary education systems, we have these conversations more robustly than in other places. Yes, please.
Thank you very much. My name is Chandra Gould. I come from the Institute for Security Studies, and my concern is around, my work is around violence and violence prevention, and my concerns relate to the need to build a new generation that is not as easily victimized and does not perpetrate violence. And a lot of my work at the moment is also focusing on parenting, and the importance of warm parenting that doesn't reinforce violence in order to grow up children that are resilient. And I just watched the first clip, watched the second clip, and I think I just wanted to raise the importance of having these kind of conversations about parenting in the context where we don't bring in notions of conservative notions of morality and the way in which families should look. So I think it was really wonderful to have those clips, because as we talk about parenting, the challenge is not to fall back on old, sad stereotypes that don't take us forward in a constructive way. So thank you.
Radical parenting. How do we do it? What's radical? What's radical? That depends on the context, right? That depends on what the norms are. But they're pretty obvious norms that exist to make gender injustice possible. And so those ones can be quickly sort of named as problematic norms. And that takes some non-conservative parenting. I've been trying to do that myself at some point. Yes, do you have a mic with you?
I do.
Fantastic.
Is it working? My name is Judy Lakesh. I was sexually abused, sodomized, raped by my grandfather and my father for 19 years. I come with a message of hope. For the past 30 years, I've been working in Cape Town with men, women, and young men, young women who have been sexually abused. Violence, emotional, whatever, all abuse is the same. And I now sit in my 66th year, and I can see that some of my work has produced results. It is possible to recover. It's a long, slow process, and it's very hard, but it is possible. And so I want to give this message of hope to you and all the people that you work with, that things can change and you can recover.
Thank you so much for sharing that. I think that the question of healing and change boggles our minds all the time. And I know for sure there are many survivors and there are many people on that path or about to go on that path in this room. But thank you for bringing your own story into the space. Right. Good. I think we have time for another clip. I just want to check in if we would like a new round of hands, because this was a contribution that, you know, people who looked at the first clip, and then I had some inputs. This side of the room, is there anyone who'd like to speak? Yes, two hands I'm seeing there. Could we get a mobile mic to that side of the room? Thank you so much. Great, go ahead. You can stand there, yes.
My name is Brian. First of all, I think I want to just thank this space, you know, for... I think this is a very relevant conversation, and there's a lot of energy on this topic on the ground, which I think sort of speaks to how quickly people were jumping for tickets.
Yeah.
What I want to say is about this, the issue of education and the conversation of gender and nations. So I think that it's very easy for us to think about, you know, South African women, what is the problem with South African women? We have to also remember that gender problems are very entwined in the fabric of human society, and we have to have an acknowledgement of the long history of gender-based violence, in all its forms. And in doing so, we also need to think about carefully what are the norms exactly, so that we can take action. What is the appropriate action? And also, what does education mean? So is it about what are children being taught in the curriculums at universities and schools? Or is it about what are they being taught at home or amongst their friends? So what am I being taught as a young man about what it is to be a man? What is allowed? What are we allowing every day about my tradition, which we protect in some spaces and deny in others? We need to think very carefully about what it means to know things and what is right, and speak very firmly about that. We always talk about education is the key. Now, actually, education is what we hope will give us the light to see what action we must take. Action is actually the key. And the problem is not abstract, it's not in conflict areas, not in townships, it's everywhere. Nothing more to say.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you, Shoma. I think we'll take one more hand, a couple of rows behind, and then we'll show another clip.
Hi, I'm Simpiu, I'm from UCT.
Yeah.
I think the problem that we have as a society is the fights within ourselves. A lot of us sit here, we don't have problems with people who are gay, but if I go home and then I tell my mom I'm gay, she'll start having a problem. But here we are preaching this thing that we should be practicing, but yet we are not practicing it in our own homes. It's a fight that we need to fight within ourselves before we can start telling people that you need to accept that person. If deep down, one day I walked in on my gay friend having sex. And I think if it was a heterosexual couple, I wouldn't have such a problem with it. We are fine with people being gay, but we don't want them to kiss in front of us. But it's fine for a heterosexual couple to be making out and we think it's cute. That is the fight that we need to fight as a society before we can start moving forward. Thank you.
Great. Very important inputs there. So these are issues that we can bring into the formal program, or they can help, you know, simmer sort of how you're thinking and perhaps inputting again later or not. Could we have the next clip? And again, through about 3 minutes in? Yeah.
It's about 2.5 minutes, and it's a clip that picks up something that Judy Lacash said and that I'm hearing from other comments about courage and about what it means to speak. Healing, yes. Solidarity, how do we work together? It's a poem written by one of South Africa's young, amazing poets, Lebo Mashile, and you need to listen and read at the same time, because it's a poem without words that are spoken, but it's going to be there.
Sorry about the lighting, so you couldn't see all the words, but hopefully you managed to capture some interesting phrases that speak to you. We'll have another round of input. I see a hand over there. Anyone this side of the room? I see a hand over there. Right. So let's move to this side of the room, and then we'll come over there. Could we have a mic here, since she's right in the middle of the aisle? Might be quicker to get a mic in. And I see one hand up on my far right. Go ahead.
Hello, everyone. My name is Ati, a UCT student. I think all the clips are very thought-provoking. But for me, as a young black woman, when you talk about gender and the issue of violence and being located in South Africa, for me, it's, you know, if you're looking for gender equality, but gender equality for who and which bodies are you looking for gender equality for? And I think looking at the Pride video, one of the problems that I've always had in that, you know, we talk about violence, but we never talk about the bodies that the violence is inflicted on. And I remember, sorry, I'm a bit nervous. I remember my sister was raped and murdered in 2010. And one of the things that struck me the most was the fact that it took forever to get police into, you know, the area where she was abducted and to actually look for her because it was a township area. And for me, it's such a stark contrast having to live in Rondebosch and at UCT where literally every 20 minutes you see police patrolling everywhere, you know. For me, it sends a different message in that whose bodies do we actually care for? You know, why is it okay for a black body to bleed? And for me, that has been the question that has gone over and over and over in my mind. And for me, I think coming from a public health sort of perspective, you always see these interventions that say change behaviors and, you know, try to, you know, come up with an intervention, go as an NGO into this community and try to correct them. But you never really get to the root of the problem as to why have our bodies been so vulnerable to violence? No one asks those questions, and it's something that we need to interrogate as well. Why is it that when I see my black brother with a hoodie in the corner, I start shaking because I'm scared he might do something to me? Why have I become scared of a black face when I'm black myself?
So I heard a lot of people resonating with your points there. So that's definitely something worth picking up, I think, later on in the conversation as well. Yes.
Thank you.
You have a mic. Fantastic.
Thank you. Igama lami nguChumani. Xa sithetha ngoMandela nangelegacy yakhe, sithetha into ezininzi. Malaika wa Africa 2 weeks ago, uye wabhala kwisane independent uthi uMandela wabantu abamnyama noMandela wabantu abamhlophe. The Mandela of whites, the Mandela of blacks. That was Malaika wa Africa. I guess for me, on the concept of gender justice, I want to touch the issue of language. And secondly, who are these people we're talking about and where are they? A good friend of mine, Temba, in the first clip, records his clip in Khayelitsha. Where are his people? Who are they? Is it possible that they are here? These black bodies that the black women talk about, why are they not here? For me, I think the injustice that is taking place within academia is the injustice in relation to language, the marginalization of African languages. Now, as black folks, we have to articulate our pain through an English language. This is a problem, okay? Now, as many others have said, that you go home, wherever home is, muchly dominated by the African languages. Now you explain this thing and then you have to come down. I would like for me really the mainstream question, to start to talk about language, to start to talk about African languages must take center stage. If we talk about Nelson Mandela's legacy, are we going to exclude his isiXhosa language, his contribution as a Xhosa man, articulating his language? And for me, it really, if we're going to start to talk justice, I think we should speak justice to that. Ngungi wa Ntiyongo put it very clear that language carries culture. This assimilation in the white supremacist ideology, it's a problem to us. There's something that we lose. Okay? Now, that is why for me, I think if we are to do gender justice, we also have to do other justices as well, particularly on the language question. I think we will go far if we are to speak our own languages. I hope our speakers today will really articulate in their own languages so that we can hear them. Language sometimes misses the point, particularly English language. I thank you.
Ziko mokwambiri, mwakamba vazoona, mkwai. Thank you very much. He said something obvious, right? Language, ideas, expression. How can we articulate the depth of what is possible if we cannot speak it in our own spoken? Powerful. So I think we have time for one more. There was a hand on my far right, up on the podium. Okay, we'll start here and we'll go up on the right podium, on the right side of the room. Go ahead.
Thank you. My name is Ndumi Funda from an organization called Uligi Sizwe. I'll be more talking about the second clip, also making some relevancy with the Women's Month, with today and yesterday. And I could see in the house it's full of women. When you watch that second clip, as a woman, I am pleading to women to unite and help us as feminists, as LGBTI people. Let's all wave one flag. If we've managed in 1956 to say malibe linye, to fight for women's rights, whether you're gay, whether you're lesbian, whether you're straight, the pain of a woman should be the same. And I'm referring this to NGOs, I'm referring this to my communities. We need to stand together. We need to fight the patriarchy. One of the things that is very sad is women, they are still in prison. We are not liberated. Women, we need to be able to stand firm and say yes, not yet, not no. Situations that we're dealing with in our communities when we fight the hate crimes, you'll find the very same people who are waving the flag and supporting the perpetrators are women. What are we then doing here? Because tomorrow when you go back to your community, you will support the perpetrator and you will say, it must happen because they're acting like men. I am pleading you people, let us stop feeling the pain when it's 9 August. Let's feel the pain from January up until another January. Thank you.
Thank you. Good morning. My name is Marion Stevens, and I work in reproductive justice, women's sexual and reproductive health and rights. Last night, I was just reading up a little bit about President Bachelet and what she'd done in relation to women's health. And apparently, when she came into her position as the Minister of Health, she, in a very conservative Catholic country, made emergency contraception available for women after sexual assault and also made sure that comprehensive sexuality education was available in schools. And I am curious that in South Africa we have got very progressive policies and legislation on areas around reproductive justice. But just 2 weeks ago, I'm sure you're all aware, and the students would have felt this in their bodies, young students in KwaZulu-Natal were essentially asked to have a 3-year implant so that they didn't shame their families and get pregnant. And I wonder what that means for us today in South Africa in 2014, when we are just not engaging with our sexual and reproductive health. Lesbian women might need contraception. Fathers want to engage with contraception. We saw the clips earlier on. Why is it that we're still being forced to have long-term methods like the injection and the implant? Why is it that we can't really even talk about abortion, really? And in our country today, we only have 54% of facilities working. And then Cape Town, in the Western Cape, there are only 2 medical doctors that provide second trimester abortions. So I just wanted to bring this to the table. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you for the last 2 inputs. Very important issues. We have the opportunity to engage with a president who has addressed some very significant matters. 9th of August is every day of the year. I hear you. I'd just like to acknowledge the presence of dignitary, if I can say that, Professor Mampela Rampela, former Vice Chancellor. Thank you very much. And also many, many other things. We're having our pre-program, so the formal program is still yet to start. At this point, I'd like to call up to the platform our key speakers, some of our key speakers who I mentioned already in the room. Buiselo Bota, please welcome. You're welcome to come up to the podium. Sitting. You know how they're sitting. Nomboniso Gaza, please, you're welcome to come and take a seat. We will introduce them formally as when the formal program starts. Let's give him a hand. Zetu Matibini, please come forward and take a seat. We're preparing for the formal program to begin. Let's give them a hand. They've been listening keenly to the things that have been mentioned. Very fortunate to have had them in the room during this conversation. Welcome. Okay, great. So are we ready to start the formal program, Jane?
If any of the speakers whom we're going to hear from later would like to say anything while we wait for the last 2 minutes for the platform party to come and for us to begin, let me say from the bottom of my heart, thank you very much for your patience and for your immediate participation in the issues. I'm feeling that even if they don't come, we could continue. We'll be very happy to see them. We're honored to be in partnership with them. But some of the issues that are very much in our hearts, souls, spirits, and minds, and languages have been raised. And it's my deep hope that we'll simply be able to transition smoothly into the next phase of the program. But Mbuiselo, Nomboniso, Zetu, do you want to make any comments before we start? I'm sorry to put you on the spot, but we've been very aware that you've been sitting in the audience, and we'd love to hear what you had to say to this pre-program stuff.
Is there anything? You need not speak at this moment, but if there's anything that you want to chip into at this stage, any of the speakers? Good? No? Okay. 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 All right. Speaker's still settling down. She's looking for something. Yeah. Great. So we have a few more minutes before. Let's see if there's any other input while we're waiting for our invited guest, important guest, to to arrive. Would anyone like to raise another point? Yes, fantastic. I see a hand over there. Could we have a mic?
Hi, good morning, everybody.
Morning.
I think there's two issues for me that I'm just wanting to raise. The one is the process of change, which has been extremely slow. And so I'm wondering, how do we accelerate change? That's the one question. The other one that I'm considering is, for me, there's an alliance between neoliberalism and democracy. And yet we often in this sector, now you say the word sector very broadly, advocate for rights. Yet the problem of individualism that neoliberalism promotes is problematic. That same problematic discourse of rights we rely on for change. So for me is how do we, what sort of frameworks of change can we speak about that's going to accelerate the issues of freedom, issues of equality, etc.
So some words there, neoliberalism, democracy, rights, individualism. Can I as an individual just change my behavior and that's enough? And legal frameworks to support or to encourage individual shifts. Is that the kind of thinking that's expansive enough, radical enough? Democracy demands that we go and vote, one person at a time. Capitalism demands that we make choices, right, to increase our pocket individually. The size of our pocket individually, as if it is just an individual choice. Is it? Good, important questions. I see two, three hands this side of the room. Okay, the mic is actually here. Fantastic.
Ndiyabulisa sihlobo zam nabantu kwethu. Yiyo lele mina engaziwa mntu. Yiyo lele mini uqhawuka kwembeleko. Endingathi bantakwethu, le mini ndiyayibulela, ndiyavuya ngale mini kaMandela. Ndibuhlungu uba wade wabe uyadlula kulo mhlaba. Ndingakhange ndambona ubuso ngobuso. Kwenzela into yokokuba kukude apho wayesuka khona, kufitshane ngaphambili. Bantakwethu, masizame abantwana bethu. Ukuqhawuka kwembeleko kufikile bantakwethu. Masizame usondela kwintsapho zethu. Abazali mabazame usondelana nabantwana babo. Kubi phandle apha. Akululanga bantakwethu. Ubuntu wabushiye tethile. Le nto ubuntu wabuhlalelwa deskini. Le nto ubuntu wabuhlalelwa deskini bantakwethu. Inimbi uqhawuka kwembeleko bantakwethu kufikile. Masisondeleni kubantwana bethu. Halala makwethu. Halala bantakwethu. Ndiyabulela ngokwenza.
Fantastic input. Buicello says he's going to start charging me for translation. I hope you're sitting next to somebody who can translate if it's not your own language. I think the point that was made this side of the room is potent at the moment in the room. Mic holders, there's another hand here, and there were three hands this side of the room. I think we're getting warm. The conversation is getting hot. Okay. We need to close the formal program. Let's welcome the presence of our hosts, Grasha Michelle. Thank you. Okay, so we start the program. Thank you very much. Yes, so I'll hand over to Jane Bennett for the official start of the program.
Siyasikilewa ukunivuya Welcome. Welcome to Kurasa Michelle, who is not only the Vice Chancellor of the University of Cape Town, but the former First Lady. And as everybody in this room knows, we are blessed to have had her energies over many, many, many years of her engagement with a very wide range of issues to do with rights, children's rights, women's rights, human rights, all of them not in the spirit of some segregated neoliberalism, but in a commitment to an imagined society, one in which the questions of violence, discrimination, hatred, and cruelty that we've been glossing as we've moved through this pre-program have no place, have in fact no language. It's clear that we have been asked to start the program without the President of Chile. We hope that she may be able to join us, and it is in fact in her name and the name of the Nelson Mandela Foundation's 12th annual lecture series that we have been honored to respond to Mama Shell's request to hold a dialogue around the issues of gender at UCT. Once again, I'm Jane Bennett, and may I welcome you on behalf of the African Gender Institute to our campus. I'd also like to welcome a number of other people in the room. Mampela Rampele, who was our former Vice Chancellor. I would like to welcome all the members of NGOs who do the kind of work at a daily basis of fighting for the questions of gender justice, whose eradication is something that sometimes it is hard to imagine. It is always useful for me to remember in this work that for many of us who were engaged in the struggle for political liberation, we do not yet have economic liberation, but we have political liberation in the years of the 70s and 80s and perhaps long before that. For some of us, it was not actually possible to imagine what it would be like. That didn't stop anybody from fighting. It didn't stop anybody from envisaging another way. Ladies and gentlemen, I believe that we are welcoming the Chilean delegates from their ministry, from their team. We welcome you to this dialogue. Tenemos el honor de darles bienvenida a nuestra universidad. Thank you very much for being with us. We anticipate the arrival of Her Excellency Michelle Bachelet, and I'm simply going to continue because we have been keeping you for a while, and we would like to move into the full program. We've heard a little sense of what some of the issues are. One thing that I would like to put into the mix,
I have a very, very smart sister. She has more houses than I know how to count, and huge intelligence. When I told her I was going to be working with this dialogue, and I was also speaking to her about issues of Marikana, issues of Palestinian conflict. Ladies and gentlemen, we are a full house. Madam President, Your Excellency, I will say it again. Tenemos el honor de darles bienvenido a nuestra universidad. Thank you very much for being here. We welcome all distinguished guests who now include the Vice Chancellor of the University of Cape Town, whom I will request in a moment to take over from me in formal introduction to Graça Michelle. To finish what I was saying beforehand, setting the tone for our discussion, so here was my very smart sister. Here was us having a conversation about political issues. Gaza, Tigran Morris, Marikana. She said to me, "Yeah, but you won't be talking about those today. Those aren't gender issues." She's my sister. Why is it that so much strategic, poetic, analytic language and movement building has forgotten what it means to take the politics of gender and sexuality seriously at every level? Why do we think Marikana is not a gender issue? How do we move forward to reintegrate the best of our experience and knowledges into what it means to take the politics of gender and sexuality seriously for political and economic liberation? I welcome and thank the Nelson Mandela Foundation for this opportunity to talk again with you, and I invite formally the Vice Chancellor of UCT, Dr. Max Price, to take the podium.
Thank you, Jane. Your Excellency, Ms. Michelle Bachelet, President of the Republic of Chile, UCT Chancellor and former First Lady of the Republic of South Africa, Mrs. Graça Michelle, former First Lady of the Republic of South Africa, Ms. Zanele Mbeki, respective ministers of the Republics of South Africa and of Chile, Ambassador of the Republic of Chile in South Africa, Mr. Gabriel Zepeda, trustees of the Nelson Mandela Foundation, and Chief Executive Officer of the Foundation, Mr. Selo Hatang, former Vice Chancellors of UCT, Dr. Mampela Rampele, President of the SRC, Chair of Convocation, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. It's a great pleasure to have been invited to host this event, this important dialogue around the position of women and gender issues at the University of Cape Town. As an institution of higher education, and especially a research institution that focuses on bringing positive change to South Africa and to other parts of the developing world, to Africa, and to the world more generally, we have a special affinity to an event such as this. Today you will meet some of our academics, and I know you have already met some of them in the pre-session, who are directly involved in teaching and research at this university and at some of the others in the region. For example, they represent the Gender, Health and Justice Research Unit, which does interdisciplinary research that unites scholars, NGOs, and practitioners in the pursuit of the elimination of violence against women and children in Southern Africa. There are speakers and representatives from the School of African and Gender Studies, Anthropology and Linguistics, from the Africa Gender Institute, which is a feminist research unit committed to political work on the African continent with a focus on writing, publications, research processes and partnerships, and network building and participative learning. The Center for Law and Society, a critical and very influential voice in debates about customary law and traditional leadership and the tensions that arise when those customary law systems live side by side or within Western constitutional democracies. The Institute for the Humanities, for the Study of the Humanities in Africa, also has a number of researchers here today who focus on gender and sexuality. So the study of gender and sexuality and reproductive health is certainly a major concern of ours. And of course, it's the implementation of that in the wider society that this dialogue hopes to promote. I have the privilege of introducing you to an individual who is the formal host of the event today, Mrs. Grasse Machel, who has played an important role in the history not only of South Africa, but certainly of Mozambique and of the African continent. And we're especially privileged to enjoy her influence at UCT as our beloved Chancellor. Mrs. Machel, born in southern Gaza province of Mozambique, there are different Gaza from the one just being referred to, studied Germanic languages at Lisbon University. And during Mozambique's War of Independence from Portugal, she worked underground in Mozambique's liberation movement, Frelimo, which had set up schools in liberated territories and within their training camps in neighboring Tanzania. After independence, she became the Secretary of State for Education in the liberated Mozambique and soon became Minister of Education and Culture in the post-independence Mozambique government and the only woman in cabinet. She held the post for 11 years and can claim many successes in that post, such as cutting illiteracy by 22% and increasing the school-going population from less than 500,000 to 1.6 million. So it is her history steeped in liberation struggle and in education that positions her particularly well to be our Chancellor and to speak to us or to host this event. She's also, as you know, worked alongside two great liberation leaders who led their respective countries to freedom, the late President Samora Machel and, of course, late President Nelson Mandela. And in both these marriages, she stood out as not only a support to her husband's work, but as a leader in her own right. So, as the Vice Chancellor of UCT, it gives me great pleasure to invite Mrs. Machel to the podium to welcome you all and to say a few words.
Good morning. President Michelle, I'm in difficulty to treat Michelle as president. I know she's president, but she has been such a good sister and friend. I always treat her as Michelle. I'm sorry, and it's not anything of disrespect, but I feel much more comfortable to say, welcome, Michelle, to this university. And welcome to all of you to this very important day for UCT. As an institution, we proud ourselves of being very much part of the debate of issues of fundamental importance for our society. UCT prouds itself of a variety of programs in which we do research, but more than doing research, we interact with communities, mostly in Western Cape where we are based, but with the whole country, But even with the rest of the continent, as you know, UCT is considered one of the best institutions, tertiary institutions in the world. We interact not only with Africa, with the global community. So it is for us a fundamental issue to debate and to find some insights for challenges which are of human race, human family nowadays. Just if I can go a little bit out of the theme, I consider that for human family today, there are two major challenges which we are grappling with. We have no clear path of how to deal with them to solve. One is race, second is gender. If you look around the world, there's no many countries who can praise themselves of having managed to have a cohesion of society in which the issue of race is not a challenge. To accept one another regardless of our pigmentation and to say race is not a problem. Even in societies which are more integrated, but if you go deep, you realize that there is still stratification on the basis of race. Am I lying? No. Second, it's gender, and which is our discussion today. And I don't intend to preempt the bright minds which are going to enlighten us this morning, but I would like just to submit this. We seem to have developed very sophisticated instruments, legal instruments, conventions, protocols, agreements, constitutions, laws, and regulations. We actually have, at least in the case of South Africa, we do have very strong institutions which are expected to implement issues of equality in our society. But it looks like the more we are conscious of this, and the more we implement them better, women are being targeted and women are victims of violence, very severe violence. It looks like the rise of women, the rise of women in the political, economic, let me say at workplace, so in public space, the rise of women in public space, it is enacting a process in which men feel they are losing power and control. And because of that, it is at the private level. It is in the family where violence is more acute. Because publicly, you have much less space of being physically violent. There's a lot of psychological violence against, even at workplace. Again, there's very few countries, I don't think there's actually any country which can say it has reached equal pay, I mean, equal work, equal pay. Although legislation is there, but a challenge is that no country can say we have reached a level in which we can say equal work, equal pay for women. So we are still at the public level, we're still grappling with that. And of course, harassment and the difficulties for promotion, all those kinds of things we know. But it is a global phenomenon today that violence against women is rife and rife. Women are being killed in the hands of those who claim to love them, those who should protect them, and they should be proud of their success. It means the more successful they are being much more targeted. So to me, I think we need to, in our debate, to continue, yes, definitely, with the public space. But maybe we have to question more deeply the private space and to question the concept and how to deconstruct the concept of masculinity. More than just gender violence, because we can say people are being targeted, just, but what is it behind this issue of masculinity? And at the end of the day, it will come back to us as women, because we are the mothers who are bringing up these boys and girls. And it is, in my view, something which we have to question very seriously, and knowing clearly it is to be tough, because it means transformation of the individual. It's not a transformation of institutions. It's not transformation of the public debate. It's transformation of the individual, men and women. And it is planting the seeds of society in which relationship between men and women are to be really rooted in equality, acceptance of one another, and to be equal. So we have a long, long journey, and I think we don't have a shortcut on this. But we need to deconstruct these issues clearly so that we know, as you were mentioning, it took us, I don't know how many decades for us to reach freedom. And freedom of spirit in this case, freedom of spirit both for men and women to accept one another as equal, it is going to take the same long road, I think. And this is what here is UCT, we offer a space for debate, taking responsibility that our own research, and I have to acknowledge many of our researchers here, heads of department, heads of institutions who have been really very, very, very much engaged with these issues, to thank you for what you have been doing, but to say we still need to interrogate even more, and we still to engage society in debate much more often. I want to finalize saying this. It strikes me that there is no much outrage. Society is not outraged against violence. We seem to be very, you know, it's okay. We know it exists, it's a problem, but we don't seem the same kind of outrage which would be accepted to say this cannot continue. So one is we have to continue with this research and the debates, but I think we need to build a social outrage, a social movement of outrage, so that those who target women, they should feel isolated. They should feel absolutely isolated. They should be ashamed of getting out of the house because they are targeting women. And it's up to us. I don't know, there's a... Well, we'll discuss this in another space. But it's up to women to engage in this movement, to say, enough is enough. We are not going to accept it anymore. And then to, of course, bring along men, bring along our young people, particularly our young men and women, our children, so they grow in an environment where they know it is unacceptable for you to violate a woman. And that's where we have to go. Thank you so much, Michelle. We look forward to your contribution and the contribution of these very, very bright minds who are sitting here. As UCT, we are really, really, really honored that during your first visit to South Africa, this is a place you felt you should come and share with us. Thank you.
Thank you, Mama Shell. Thank you for those words. Yaliwe Clark works at the African Gender Institute. She has been working with us this morning, facilitating some of the discussion. She herself has very deep activist and research interests in issues of peace and violence and women's peace activism in Eastern Africa and Southern Africa. It's my honor to ask her to introduce to you Her Excellency, the President of Chile.
Good morning, everybody. I'm very excited to be here. My heart is racing. Yes, Her Excellency, the President of Chile, Michelle Bachelet, we welcome you to this debate with great pride and honor. In December 2013, you won a landslide victory in the first ever presidential race between two women candidates, giving her a second term in the top decision-making position in Chile. This is your second term of office. Prior to being elected in December 2013, you took on the position of the first head of the newly established UN Women, a new agency that was created to profile gender issues and women's issues. This organization is currently being run by the former Vice President of South Africa, Phumzile Mlambo-Ngcuka. I'm also aware of your history in Chile's contested, as many political histories are contested. President Bachelet was herself arrested, tortured, and exiled between 1973 and 1990 during the dictatorship of General Augusto Pinochet, and so has a long history of political radicalism, if I can call it that. Besides naming the first cabinet, one of the first, perhaps the first cabinet with gender parity, she has also given visibility in her speeches and in, I would call it, political and grounded activism on gender equality. And this conversation that she has made prominent still exists and persists in Chile. In her accomplishments include the 2008 reform of the pension system in Chile, which introduced a basic pension for poor homemakers who have never earned a wage outside the home, as well as a stipend per child for all mothers. Another flagship program of administration, which has been replicated in other countries in the region, is the Integral Protection System. She has also made strides in terms of early childhood and a program called Chile Crece Contigo. I'm not sure of the pronunciation. Chile Grows With You. And this is a program that provides supports for parents and children from conception through to age 4. Madam President, during our pre-conversations, as we're waiting for you to come, one of the people in the audience mentioned the kind of innovative work you've been doing in reproductive health for women in Chile, providing contraceptive care and also medication in the event of violence and rape and sexual violence. Other major gains for women in her government include the large number of free day centers and nursery schools established throughout the country, which have given women more freedom to enter the labor market and a law aimed at bridging the gender wage gap that Gracia Michelle mentioned. We are making progress legally, but still practically yet to make progress. And this gender wage gap also grants labor benefits to domestic workers, another area of the labor force that is still across the world dominated by women. I'm sure there is more to say about Her Excellency, and we're really honored to have you present to share some of the recent work that you've been doing, but also to give input on this conversation we're having here in South Africa. What does it mean to make substantive gender justice possible? Thank you very much. Let's welcome Her Excellency to the podium.
Well, thank you so much. And because I'm late, I couldn't change my clothes because we're coming from Robben Island. And of course of that, I'm not going to say the whole name of the people who are here. So we're going to say all protocols observed and dear friends, and we'll include everyone in dear friends. You just mentioned part of my history, of my, the things I've done in life. But I just want to start saying I have done a lot in my life in social matters, in health, pension, childcare. I was the first female Minister of Health of my country, but probably nobody would have seen me as a possible president if it weren't because I was also the first female Minister of Defense. And I'm saying this because we're talking about power, Graça was telling us. And I'm saying that because it's not only having the truth or being right what will permit women to play the role and to have the opportunities and ensure the rights I should. We need to do much more than that. Just to be the right position is not enough in the world. And it has always been like that, and you know it so well from your own history. So having said that, let me say that it is a special honor for me, this getting together with all of you the day after celebrating National Women's Day, recognizing those women who bravely mobilize and stand against arbitrary discrimination and oppression of the apartheid, but demonstrating the action slogan that women really do have the strength of a rock. And I do believe that women have the strength of a rock. So that's why when we're discussing UN Women, because it was supposed to be UN Women, that was the short name for the UN, Women's Organization for Gender Equality and Women's Empowerment. But to be honest, I don't think we need to empower women because women are powerful. What we need to do is to enable all the conditions so those powerful women can really do what they want to do in terms of politically, socially, economically, etc. Having said that, let me start with three ideas. The first is that when you look at the history of the world, of course we can say there has been important progress made on equality struggles over the past decades. Second, that we have a lot pending tasks, none of them which can be put off any longer. And third, equal, inclusive, or harmonic development is not possible in the world if we do not put gender equality at the top of the list of challenges that we, states and NGOs and universities, etc., of the world must address. And listening to Graça, she mentioned two essential issues that we need to deal much better with it because we're yet far away where we should be. And you mentioned race and gender. And I was thinking, and that we could also include it in diversity, because we are not dealing well with diversity. Could it be ethnical diversity? Could it be sexual orientation? Could it be all kinds of diversity in the world? And we're not dealing well with that either. Yes, we have had progress on health and education in the world history in the last decades, if we compare it. But poverty has mainly a female face. 800 women still die daily while giving birth. Still today, women's presence in higher education, politics, and paid employment remains the minority. Or I should say, women in decision-making position still very rare. And in Latin America, for example, 85 women die when you take the rate of maternal mortality, 85 in 100,000 births women die, and in sub-Saharan Africa is 646 every 100,000 births. In the female workforce, 53% of the developed world, I mean the female are 53% of the task force, of the workforce, 26 in the Middle East and North Africa. In Chile it's in between, 42, and in order to get there we had to include a lot of different policies, policies towards children, childcare, and others that will permit really women to have access to work in adequate condition.
In education in the developed world, nearly all girls reach primary education. In sub-Saharan Africa, 42% no more than 4 years of schooling, and in South Asia, 35% in the same condition. So what is my conclusion about this? It's not only that we have a lot of pending tasks, but also is that egalitarian struggle show very different results in different parts of the world. So we need to have strategies for a double inequality. The inequality in each country between men and women, and it's completely truth. There's no country in the world that is equal pay to equal job. Neither in the Nordic countries that are supposed to be the more advanced in terms of rights. So everybody has to do much better on gender issues. But having said that, of course, there are countries with much, much terrible condition for women. So we need to have, as I said, a different strategies for the double inequality, the relation with and the opportunities and the rights of women and men, but also the relationship on women between countries or inside the countries. Majority of the countries have ratified the CEDAW Convention, and more than half here in Africa have ratified the Protocol of the Right of the Women in Africa. Yet, Grasa was remembering us that even though we have this important amount of legal frameworks, laws, conventions, etc., we haven't advanced in the same rhythm. I would say we discuss a lot and we work a lot on this in UN Women. When you look at violence against women, it's worldwide. Violence against women, you will see it in rich people, poor people. You will see it in very educated family and with no education. You will see it in all parts of the world. So what we're doing wrong? Or what is what we haven't addressed yet? I don't have the answer, I'm sorry to say, otherwise probably I will win the Nobel Prize, but I have some ideas anyway. Because as I said, we still have big inequalities. I think one of the things, it happens not only with gender issues, but it used to happen more with gender issues because sometimes people in parliaments, in governments, they do understand they need to do much more for women. But not necessarily that is completely embodied. So what's happened is that you have a good law, but there's no budget for it. So there's no way to implement it. Or you have a law, you have a budget, but you don't have really the political will. So there's so many factors you have to deal with in terms of making that legal framework work for women adequately. Or some other times the laws are looked in a partial way and not in a comprehensive way. One of the things that I concern about, for example, in violence against women, because we're not talking here about rocket science. We know what works on violence against women. But there are some things that probably we're not doing yet. It's not only about prevention, about promotion of healthier forms of relationship between children. And for me, one important thing of the nurseries that we develop in my country is I think you, from the beginning, from the very early stages, you need to develop a culture of relationship, of respect between people, men, women, girls, boys, diversity and respect for diversity in our societies. One of the things is that we are leading sometimes to the consequences, but we're not leading with the factors leading to discrimination, leading to violence or abuses. Because we all know that violence is not, and particularly sexual violence, is not about sex. It's about power. It's about domination, or sometimes humiliation even, when we're talking about sexual violence in war, as a mean of war. But there's still a lot of things that I think we haven't touched yet. And the thing is that there's no one, not only is there no one size fits all, but there's no one recipe or no one tablet that will solve the problem. We need to have a comprehensive approach. We need to deal with many different things. And of course, we need women leaders, role models, strong women that can show that women can. It's amazing that we need to demonstrate that in the world, but still it's like that. You know, in Chile, we have advanced. This is my second term. We skip a period because in my country we cannot be re-elected immediately. And now you have a female president of the republic. We have right now the female president of the Senate. We have a female as in the biggest confederation of trade unions in my country. And we have female at the biggest students association of the biggest university in my country. So you look at that, you will say, okay, that's the perfect world for women. Not yet. We have only 17% of female in parliament. So the thing is that because we have all these women, I'm sure it will be faster, we will be move faster. And for the first time this year, we will be able to put in place a quota law for women. Because for many years I've been trying to do that, I never had the support from the political parties. But now, and I think it's because women, we have been paving, you know, the way, that now it's impossible for them to say no anymore and to have good arguments. So what I'm saying is that even though things are not as we would like, we are been improving and we need to continue improving. But there's other things that are invisible. And feminist groups and women movement has been speaking for so long about glass ceiling. But what do we know now? That glass ceiling, yes, but it's not only glass ceiling. It's a leaking pipeline. It's invisible bias. And there is a fantastic work on Harvard Business Review that shows how it works. They said that this was an organization who wanted to promote somebody. And they interview a woman and a man. So the women did the interview, the panel said, oh, she has fantastic performance records. Her interview was not that good. She's insecure. Then came the man, and they said he had fantastic records of performance. His interview is not that good. He has potential. So it's not a joke. It's reality. And when I told this to the head, the new female head of the national television in France, she said, oh my God, I just did that last week. This woman she interviewed, she was telling her, you know what, I'm good at this, but this is not my best part. I have to tell you and so, but I'm very good at that. So she said, oh, she's insecure. And then come this guy like that. I'm the one you need, you know. I'm the perfect one for the job. And she said, great, I got that. And it's reality. And you live it as a reality. And as a president for so many much time, people will say, she's so nice. She's charismatic. But nothing about my ideas, my proposals, the policies that I wanted to implement. So that intention to invisibilize women, to deny their capacities is there. And you have to work with that and struggle with that. Why I mention this leaking pipeline and bias? Because we need to go deeper and see and see not only the consequences and some roots, but that we know. And many has been written and many has been researched. But I think we need to have a more comprehensive approach in order to really move faster. One of the things that is not easy at all is politics. I would say, and I come from politics, so it's not that this woman came here to talk about politicians, but I can tell you it's one of the hardest part. And probably because politics has been in the hands of men traditionally, but it is very important. And in the world, we have 70% of female ministers, 17, when in the world, probably women are majority, like 51%. And it's only 22% of female parliamentarians. It has increased, though, but it increases at a rhythm like 1% in 5 years and many years. So what to do about that? When I was executive director of UN Women, and I had to promote and to, if I would say, sell the idea, I was asking myself, I come from the political world, how should I speak to the politicians? Because at the end, it is at the personal level, but you need to be able to grab that opportunity at the personal level. You need to have a real environment that will permit that. Because otherwise, there will be women in very spectacular positions, but there will be exceptions, cases. So we need to continue doing all that we have talked about it in an adequate way. Of course, all the legal frameworks, and usually you need to update them. For example, we are updating now our law against violence against women because we have found some gaps that we need to solve adequately. We need more powerful women in leading positions because they are role models for other women. And in my country, when I was a kid, I would have never thought to be a president. Even 2 years before being a president, I never thought I was going to be a president, to be honest. But it was not in my dreams, if I would say. But now many little girls in my country said, auntie, because they said auntie to the older people, I want to be a president in the future. So you're opening the possibilities of everything is possible. Of course, one of the other things that's very important, not every woman is gender sensitive. And being in Davos, there was this businesswoman, and they told me, I'm successful because I'm good, not because I'm a woman. And I would tell them, I was elected president because I'm good, but because I was in that position, I wanted not to lose any other good women in my country, so to give them the opportunities, ensure the rights. But you cannot imagine how many women are not gender sensitive. They don't see the obstacles, maybe because they had a privileged life, and that's okay. But the truth is, and why I'm mentioning, is because we need men on board, and one of the things is, we don't need only women talking about women, we know everybody committing and talking and looking and acting how we improve women's life, because it's men and women's life, but particularly we're talking today about gender issues. But we need to network, we need to work together, women need to develop more solidarity with others. If there are new people in town, in business, and so on, to mentor others and to organize groups, and as Grasa was telling us, to outreach, social outreach, to move. And we need more economic, social, and political empowerment. Education is essential. All the studies in Latin America shows that the future of a little boy in a rural area in Latin America, the main factor that will help them be somebody that he wants really to be in the future is the education of the mother. And these are really new studies, and a lot of them, so it's essential. And finally, I would say to generate all the conditions for women to be able to make decisions in all dimensions of his life. But again, essentially what we need, and that's the more difficult part, and that's what laws don't change. It's a cultural change. It's a cultural change in terms of the role, the figure, how we understand the role of human beings and women there as a human being with all the rights and opportunities that we all deserve. But for that, first, we need to not only laws, but also what I call symbolic gestures. I mean, it's true. It's not only that I was Minister of Defense. Some people say there was this flaws in the city, and then I went to be, as Minister of Defense, I went to go around to see what was going on, and because we were sending the people from the conscription to help, you know, take the water out of the houses and the mud and so on. So the general said to me, Madam Minister, it's very difficult to get there. Please, let's go in a tank. So I stood up in the tank, and then this guy took a photo of me. First in the newspaper, the photo of me, you know, like with uniform in a tank. I'm not proposing all women to do that. I just want to tell you that many of my friends who wanted to be president, they will ask me, can you lend me a tank, please? Because maybe what I mean to tell you is that there are some powerful symbolism that I think it doesn't need to be a tank. I'm not talking about, in my case, is what everybody said, that everybody look at me with different eyes, you know? Oh, come on, she can make it. She can deal with the militaries. So maybe she's powerful enough to be president of the republic. There's other kind of symbolic things. But what I'm saying is not only about laws. We need to go more further, and we need to find other issues. But finally, laws, symbolic gesture, role models, but women as active citizens. And because on the personal level, you also have to do all those things. You have to have a gender perspective. You have to raise your kids with real values of equality and human rights. But you also need a society that gives you all the opportunities so you can really have the life we all deserve. Thank you very much.
I wish we could have heard you speak for another hour and had 16 rounds of question and answer, but we need to move on with our program, and due to the time factor, what we'll do now is have the three speakers respond, and you're welcome to respond to each other, but the first speaker, Noboniso Gaza, I will invite you to respond to President Bachelet's input. If you can, if there's something that that resonates with some of the things you were going to say. But we still hope to have an interaction with the audience. So please, Nomboniso Gaza, I'd just like to say a few words about you and bring you. So she's an ardent feminist, activist, writer. And she's written a book that I've certainly drawn on, which she has three chapters, Women in South African History. And she also has been writing on the making of a man amongst Amakosa. Cut. Please come forward. We welcome you to make your input.
So let's be clear. The time is what?
The time now is 12:45.
No, I have how many time? How many minutes?
5 minutes.
5 minutes, okay. The only thing that probably is relevant in my bio is that I am the research associate with the Center for Law and Society. And it is from this perspective that I'm going to approach the topic today. This also happens at a time when I'm mulling in my mind Mamuno Sizwe's very provocative presentation. Mamuno Sizwe is Grasa Machel, right? Very provocative presentation at Mistra, which was a reflection on Mozambicans' struggle and particularly the philosophy, or rather the approach to tribal identities. And I found that very, very interesting because President Samora Machel, as well as Frelimo, as well as the African National Congress and all of us, et cetera, believed that tribalism is undermining, it undermines the national identity and national liberation. And there's a reason for that, and that remains valid in terms of colonial legacy and in terms of apartheid. Then she comes back so many decades later, and then she says, well, maybe we might have gotten this a little bit wrong. Maybe we put too much emphasis on the need for the tribe to die in order for the nation to survive. And what we do need to understand is that it's important. The tribe is important as an original seed in order for the nation to live. Now, I'm trying to grapple with this. So here's my question. What is freedom? What do we understand by freedom? Freedom, as Angela Davis says, has got multiple meanings, and it's a state that is never fully acquired. It's a destination. It's something that you have to continue to deepen, to revisit, and to refine. President Michelle Bachelet yesterday said that representative democracy is no longer enough. And in fact, I'm sure we both agree it never was enough. And that people want more from their governments, from their societies, than just mere representative democracy. Mrs. Michelle says that it seems in South Africa that the more structures that are created and the more laws and the more women seem to be visible, the more violence is facing them. I want to argue that actually the problem is in the point of origin. It is in the point of how we conceptualize freedom. It is in the point where we conceptualize these structures. It is in the point where we conceptualize what gender equality is. Here we are talking about structural inequality. We are talking about an identity that is so deeply embedded. People fight to death claiming that heterosexuality is not African. And you look at them in the name of culture, they say, but this is not us. And I say, I'm sorry, but you know fuck all about your culture and African sexuality. Because if you do, you would know that African sexual ambiguities have been as much a part of who we are since time immemorial. So when you don't name these things, when you don't talk about violent masculinities, when you don't talk about militarized masculinities, when we have the general, 15 years after freedom, coming in and telling us, stomach in, chest out. And we talk about war against poverty. We talk about war against violence against women. We talk about our language is military. And indeed, if our language is military, our thinking is military. And our behavior is military. Our economy is militarized. Whether it is through the barrel of the gun or whether it is through using other forms of violence. It is important, therefore, that we recognize that in the world right now, we are facing a deeper crisis than we can imagine, and that is a crisis of imagination. It is a crisis of revisiting things anew, describing the problems anew, and revisiting that which we hold dear and that which I, as a 14-year-old who was detained, believed in, and thinking, perhaps I need to refine my thinking. This is important for us, as Cynthia Enloe says in her book, A Curious Feminist. She says, it is important, curiosity is important for feminists, because if we're not curious, we do what we have done all over again. And then she says that ultimately what happens is there's one word that comes out when we are no longer curious, and that word is always. We have always done things this way. It is our tradition to do this thing. It is our culture to do this thing. And we need to be able to say, let us be curious. The situation calls for us to be very, very curious and to be very, very, to have a daring imagination. To say to our presidents, and I'm going to be very controversial here, to say to our presidents, I'm sorry, if that is your definition of Africanness, keep it to yourself. That definition of Africanness is not me. You don't speak for me. When you speak chauvinism, when you speak heterosexism, you don't speak for me. When you come with laws ostensibly to reverse the legacy of apartheid in terms of marginalization of African customary law and in terms of marginalization of African customary systems, and in fact you deeply embed the apartheid system of thinking and to deeply embed the colonial defined way of culture and tradition, that you are no longer thinking as a government, you have reverted to always, and it is a tradition. And that is not helping us right now. Thank you.
Thank you, Nomboniso. President of Chile, Ma Michelle, thank you. Board of Trustees from the Nelson Mandela Children's Fund, thank you so much. I just want to read to you what my daughter, yesterday at 6 in the morning, I wrote my daughter, she is 20 years old. That means she was born on the 25th of September, 1994. So she is what we'd call Mandela's children. I wrote her a piece. I said to her, Nana, Happy Women's Day. This is what she wrote. She writes back. Thank you, Papa. I am independent because of you. And I wrote back, I said, Nana, I am a man because of you. I just want to foreground what I'm going to say. I just want to say, to foreground what I'm going to say, that the elephant in the room is the role of men. And until and unless, as societies, President, until and unless we focus decisively, consciously, on what is my role, and the men that are here this afternoon in this room, to ask yourself a simple question: what have I done? I've kept quiet. When someone sees it, and to acknowledge your pain, a young woman spoke about the death in the family, to say that every day, and we can't just go on and not acknowledge your pain and what you went through as well, you've been sexually violated, to acknowledge that pain, but to say it was done by a certain man. And it is our duty this afternoon, Mama Michelle, to say, how do we then speak? Mam Dlamini, how do we, with the programs that you so wonderfully pursue in the social development, how do we ensure that men are at the center, not only as perpetrators, but as catalysts for change? How do we, in the organization I come from, at Sonke Gender Justice Network, how do we make sure that the one man can, the brothers for life, it becomes our daily discussions? How do we make sure that at Constantia, at Nyanga, every day this man, when a man wakes up, he knows that I, one man can, I have to bring a difference in the lives of other men? How do we ensure that that young man who grows in Khayelitsha, who has never met a father, who has never been embraced by a father, that girl who grows up, who has never had the privilege of being told, I love you. And this, you may think, are inconsequential, are immaterial, but in the bigger scheme of things, they're critical. As we talk about the liberation, as we talk about gender, the dynamics of it, we must always be reminded that that boy has done what he does, mainly because there's never been a father figure. In the work we do at Sonke in one community, 7 boys were involved in raping a young girl who had a problem, mental faculties. But Mama Michelle, what was very common, Minister Bajamini, what was common about all of those girls, of those boys, was that they never had a father figure in their lives. So it's important to centralize and situate the role, the important role that we can play, we must play, we should play as fathers in this day and age. If we are to stop violence against women and children, investing in the young boys, boys who grow up hopeless, who grow up helpless, boys who'd not care to take a life because of a cell phone, because they are surrounded by material conditions that militates against them growing up. We're in a country that had normalized violence, a country that had normalized poverty. The one thing that you do, I thought you'd give me more minutes because of my disability. I'm disappointed. I'll tell Spongandjalo, my daughter, and say, Nana, they treat us the same. They violate us. I'll tell my daughter Spongandjalo. Yeah. Well, I've something I didn't tell you is that I have two disabilities. The one is my surname, and the other one is this one. I got shot by police in 1986 in the head. The bullet went through during the liberation of this country. That's why we must never forget or take for granted this freedom, that people died for this freedom. People paid the ultimate price. And President Mandela became that embodiment of that struggle. He became, and this is what you said, President, from Chile, what you said yesterday, that, President Mandela, what kept him alive was whenever he saw South Africans, he saw himself in us. So it's important that we must never for one moment even forget that people paid the ultimate price. But also to go back and say, if you engage in men, you must also be alive to their struggles every day. That this man wakes up unemployed, with no prospect of finding employment. How do I come to him and say, but you know, gender equality, you know, empowerment of women, when he himself does not know where his next meal will come from? It's important that the university, we get seized with these things. If we forget these struggles, if we forget poverty, inequality, if we forget the struggles, we will not be able to deal decisively with violence against women. I just want to say, as I close, let's invest in the boy child. I would like you to support the work that we do in the world, in the country, that boy needs your hug. That boy needs you to speak life in his lifeless life. Thank you.
President Bachelet, Mama Gracia Michelle, Program Director, Professor Jane Bennett, VC, Dr. Max Price, and everybody here today. Molweni, molo kakhulu ko mama, ndiyabona bahleli kwelaa cala. Thank you for the opportunity to raise these issues, and I want to take a particular note from where Mama Michelle left off, and that is to talk about the outrage that you say we do not have. And I want to connect that to the talk that President Bachelet gave yesterday and today, that focuses and highlights and almost encourages issues around diversity and the importance of difference. And these are important issues for me, particularly as a member of many groups who sit on the margins of society in South Africa. So I will read. But as I stand here, I stand here remembering the pains and the gains of the many women who marched and paved the way for us. I wonder why I remain enraged. Enraged by the silences that continue to mute the experiences we carry on our bodies. Earlier, Ati talked about that. I'm enraged that 6 years into the Women's Charter, life for many women has remained the same. I'm troubled that the silences exposed by women such as Tenji Wemdizo, Zubeda Jaffa, and many more in the earlier liberation movement are still deafening. I'm outraged that after so many years with the promise of freedom, many women cannot openly claim their right to sexual dignity, economic and social justice. Mama Shell, we are outraged. We are outraged by the violence that is happening on our bodies, our psyches and our spaces. We are angered that here in Cape Town, Nonsekelo Kyakyaka's murderer continued to roam around township streets, greeting Nonsekelo's mother and bragging to friends about how he killed the 21-year-old woman. After refusing to sleep with him, he murdered her. He wrapped her body in a blanket. Only a year later was her body found, dumped and decomposed in a rubbish bin in the murderer's yard. How can we not be outraged when men think they can take our bodies without our consent? When they believe that a woman's sexuality is only for the preserve of men? And when a woman is a lesbian, her sexual preference, who she is, and her political stances are an invitation to harm and violate her body? How can we keep silent when our bodies are chopped and mutilated? When Thapelo Makutle's murderer in Kuruman in Northern Cape believed, like many people in this country and in this continent, that being a gay man or a transgender person or a lesbian is ungodly and African. The murderer expressed his prejudice and beliefs by beheading 23-year-old Thapelo Makutle. He hacked his head off, his genitals, cut out his tongue, and then stuffed his testicles in his mouth. Where is the humanity in our time, when prejudice and hatred precede the appreciation for difference and love? To whom can we run when the criminal justice system fails us, when our perpetrators are let free, because when we die, our deaths and the sorrows of our families become insufficient evidence to arrest a known murderer? When our activism towards justice is delayed by court postponements, when a mother awaits for her child to come home only to find out that the boy next door has kidnapped her child, violated her body, and left her to die after inserting a toilet brush into her vagina. We cry with Duduzile Zozo's mother, who continues to go to courts hoping for justice for her daughter's death. We cry with her as she waits for her eldest daughter, the sole breadwinner, to return home and put food on the table. We mourn with her even when our sorrow mutes our pleas. We choke in grief because we know that here in this country, in this continent, to be a black woman, a lesbian, a transgender, or an intersex person is to have a political battle waged on our bodies. African presidents erect their elections on the bodies of women, on lesbians and gay bodies, on bodies they deem uncultured and African. As women from Nigeria to South Africa, we express our outrage and we forge our connections forced by the urgency to resist the forms of domination that aim to keep our sexuality and gender in a position of inferiority and subordination. History has shown us, Mama Shell, that freedom comes with taking risks. Like many who have risked their lives, their children, and families for this nation and the liberation of people, we continue this work. This is the question you asked us. We continue this work of liberation, until we all are free.
That was Zetu Matibini, feminist, writer, thinker, artist, filmmaker, an inspiration.
We also heard from Buisel Obota, activist, radical, father. And one thing, I just want to say thank you for taking Julius Malema to court for his utterances about the rape trial, the Zuma rape trial. I am indebted to you. Okay, we have a few minutes to speak amongst ourselves, to engage with our last three speakers. The President, His Excellency, will need to leave very soon, and so we will speak for the next 7 minutes. We had a pre-dialogue. Please, those who are willing to speak, grab a mic. Those who are close to the microphone, please make your way to the two microphones in the aisle. Otherwise, raise your hand and I'll identify you to speak from where you are. There is a hand in the audience there. I have some people moving towards the mic in the center. Please, we'll take as many as we can. I'll go three at a time and see if there's any possibility for quick responses. There's two mics, so two people can stand at the mic towards the back of the aisle. Fantastic. So could we have the first intervention?
Okay, hi, President Bachelet, welcome. My name is Jabu, and I'm from an organization, Iranti.org. I just have a short question for you, an advice question. In June this year at the United Nations, Chile boldly voted against a normative definition of the family. And South Africa, the definition of family. And the fact that the UN Women and the United Nations still want to push a very traditional definition of the family. What is it that we can do? And South Africa actually voted in favor of a traditional definition on the family. South Africa, with its progressive constitution, with its human rights mandate, voted in favor of this. Chile voted against. Thank you for voting against this definition. How is it that we can move ahead at a global level on changing what is becoming more and more traditional values and norms? So when we speak about the family, we really have to be cautious about this word, because we have to keep explaining its diversity so that it doesn't reinforce a stereotype. How do we do that?
Thank you for that question. Fantastic. Could we move to the person standing at the mic towards the end of the aisle, if you could go next? Yes, and then we'll come back to the mic in front. Go ahead.
Good afternoon, Madam President Bachelet and all protocol observed. I thought on the theme of outrage, I would like to honor the Kulamani members who are present in this hall today. Kulamani, will you please stand up? Kulamani members. President Bachelet, we have 85,000 members of Kulamani. Kulamani means to speak out. Most are women. All are survivors of gross human rights violations and torture. We are outraged that the South African government believes, as you said yesterday, that if people die, maybe the pain of the past will go with it. It won't. What is happening is the next generation are taking forward the struggles of their parents. This struggle for acknowledgement of the past will not go away if it's not properly reckoned with. In Chile, you had two TRCs. We've only had one, very incomplete one. We need to learn from you. And just a little bit of hope. Some of the women are doing an Arplera workshop with a Chilean woman who's going to teach how to stitch our stories. And we hope to share our stories of apartheid with you, because the women have shared their stories of the dictatorship and disappearances that has inspired us. So I want to thank your people and thank you too.
Thank you very much. Let's move forward to the front mic. Please go ahead. You have 60 seconds.
I'm Andy Kawa from an organization called Kwanele. Enough is enough.
Kwanele. Yes.
We say it is enough of silence, the silence that makes victims invisible. It is enough of fear, the fear that stigmatizes, and the fear that makes people and families be silent about perpetrators around them. We say it is enough of apathy. It is time for South Africa to be outraged and take a stance against gender-based violence. We based our activities on a preface that was made in a book of UNESCO by Nelson Mandela, by the late Nelson Mandela. The things I will summarize what he said. The book was Broken Bones, Broken Bodies. It was a study of sexual violence throughout the country. He first mentioned that it is not enough to get the liberation of the country. We need to get the liberation of communities and individuals. In South Africa, because of crime and gender-based violence, we don't have that liberation of individuals. He said that safety and security needs public and private consensus. So we need to stand together as active citizens and fight against this violence. I think that we need a second wave of liberation against gender-based violence. I include men who are also violated.
As Ilitela Bantu, in its 25th year journey in the fight against violence on women and children, I'm not going to be taking time going that. We are on a journey of redefining what rape and sexual abuse is all about. We are saying, let us all get together in the social outrage against putting more emphasis on the harm against the body, which can be washed with water and soap, but look at other means of dealing with the ruptured souls of the people. By that, we want to put a challenge to all of us by saying, let us plead with the government to refrain from fragmentizing those services through selective funding, but look at, don't pitch each other against the activism, because activism have died. We need to say today and tomorrow, we need to look at programs that are going to be looking at removing the shackles of poverty that makes us victims rather than by social beings that are responsible for their care. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think what we'll do is we'll take the last two people lined up and just check in with our speakers for any quick response. Yes? So let's move to the mic that's at the far end of the aisle, and then we'll come forward.
Good morning to everyone. When Professor Bennett was saying, explaining the story of her sister about those art and gender issues, and I was saying, I'm coming from the climate change community, and we share lots of these frustrations also, where climate change is not an issue by itself, but it's about energy and mining and competitiveness and our consumption patterns, behaviors, etc. And so we felt that also we would like here to bring that we need to kind of also bring build bridges between the gender and the climate change issues. And so I'm part of a South-South collaboration where the government of Chile and South Africa, I'm very engaged, also academics, UCT with the Universidad de Chile and Católica, and we're exploring different development paths to transition to a low-carbon economy, society that is equal and fair. And I think the MAP Chile team is doing a great job in having this conversation, but I think it's fair to say, and I would like to ask the colleagues in Chile, but that we, like, so MAP Chile, like the South Africans, are struggling to address the gender issues in there. And therefore, if I may, I had like 2 points for consideration for Her Excellency Michelle Bachelet. So there's a next opportunity now in the Ban Ki-moon summit in few months' time, and we're already doing some steps in making the sustainable development goals, talking to climate change goals. So maybe the Chilean can also play a leadership role in that sense and making talk each other. And also maybe considering how to continue these conversations, domestic conversations like MAP Chile, but also many other initiatives, to have these conversations on what's the Chile we want and how does the Chile looks like, and it should be this comprehensive approach where we all talk to each other, climate change, gender, and other social equity, like inequality, other issues.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Let's have a last input.
Hi, good day. My name is Danique Smith, and I'm a 20-year-old, and I'm a victim of domestic violence. I'm currently residing at an NGO called the Sharky Bartman Center for Abused Women and Children, which has been my home, my safe haven, and my place to heal for the first 5 months after I had the courage to leave. I'm going to share a bit of my story to help you to understand how all our lives are affected by all the issues that you have mentioned today. I did not grow up with parents, right? So ultimately, I seeked for love in a man, right? I stuck in that situation for 7 years because I had no way out. I had nothing else, right? I have matric, I did all the necessary things that I could have done. At the center, they empower us, we get computer courses, we do things to empower ourselves. But the reality of our situations is, where do we go from here, right? I don't have money to go and study, but I'd love to study. We don't have housing. We apply for jobs like crazy, but nothing comes our way. We are given the time to, pick ourselves up, to do what we are able to do ourselves. But I mean, where do I go from here? The shelter helps a lot of people, and we have a certain time frame. So after that time frame expires, where do I go? What do I do? And this is an issue that is affecting each and every woman sitting in our row, because that's the reality of our situation. We have kids, you know, my kids are in foster care because I'm not able to care for them, but yet I'm a woman standing who has been through hell and who has the determination to make something of my life, to turn my life around. But where does the help come from? You know, as we've done what we could from outside. So all I can basically say is that as women who have been abused, we pray for a bright future that will, that will help us forget the pain of the past, but an outreach needs to come into place.
Thank you very much for sharing that. Very powerful input. Very powerful inputs. I'm looking to the panel. I know Madam President needs to leave. I'm looking to the panel, but I just want to check in if there is any response.
One thing I want to thank for the testimonies and of your experience, personal experience, or your experience on struggling against violence against women and for gender issues. And of course, climate change is always has to include the gender perspective. In Rio +20, we try so much, but we got so little at the end because other things were considered more important for others, for the ones who were making decisions. So I think on gender issues, in all its diversity of issues we've been talking and listening today, we need to be, yesterday I was mentioning
relating on one hand how Nelson Mandela looked at the attitude toward things, but remember this rainbow poet that he said that you always have to have a burning patience. That means not to be patient, not to stop being outraged, what needs to be, we need to feel outraged about, but needs to understand we need to be working very strongly, and we'll have to continue doing it every day of our lives, because women had never got anything for free. And we will continue conquering and combating and struggling for our rights. But you ask me, my friend, how do you do that? Let me tell you something. Probably my predecessor would have approved the traditional concept. I come from a traditional family, but I have been for so many years the head of a family. So for me, it's obvious. It has been obvious that you can never speak about one single type of families. In my country, there are many kinds of families. Men, women, monoparental, men or women, single, same-sex families, etc. So how you make that reality is taking as a as an important thing by the one who makes decisions, I cannot give you the answer. I just think we need to speak out loud about the things. People need to continue organizing, and I'm completely convinced of what somebody of you said. Women's organizations, NGOs, civil society need support. Because government has some role to do. And sometimes, because of different reasons, political mainly, cultural sometimes, or economic, they can go further. So we need the civil society to also, from bottoms up, push the government so they can move the line, if I may say. But we really need you. We really need you, because sometimes you will have a president or prime minister in those cases that is willing to do because it's in its bones, it's in its reality and really believe it. But some others need to be pushed, need to be incentivized, if you might say. So please continue doing what you've been doing, because I know that the world needs you and the women of the world needs you in all our diversity. Men also, and of course, what you said, engage men is essential. One of my frustrations as UN Women Executive Director, that I went over the world and there were only women first, when we talk about it, and second, only women that we were convinced about the things. And that happens to me now when I'm a president of the Republic and I go to a place where everybody loves me, and I said, I don't want this kind of acts where everybody there thinks the same as me, because what I want to convince people who don't think like me that we need to do a fiscal reform, what we need to do a educational reform. So don't make me think that we're all the same. Let's go to the people who think differently, who don't agree on what I'm saying. So, and I think that's a job we need all to do together. But so, just one last thing about violence against women. Of course, violence against women need a political will, need budget, need shelters, need judicial systems that works accordingly to it. We need to work with the health sector, with the judicial sector, and with the police forces, so they're really sensitive about this. And sensitive mean to caring about the women, but also doing what they have to do, making the perpetrators, you know, receive what they need to receive. But also, I think we need to think in a different way. And what made me think of that, and even though when I went to Denmark, Sweden, nobody's doing what I'm going to say, and I think if we're not doing it, we're not going to make things right. Some pains are forever. That's true. Political pains, emotional pains, to be a victim, of course, is something that isn't there. But speaking with women, who were victims
of trafficking for sexual, as for sexual trade, if I may say. They said that usually all kinds of programs are very short, just some months, some years. So we are not doing almost anything on secondary prevention with the kids that were victims of violence, or they witnessed violence, or the death of one of their parents. And they, these women, that they were victims of human trafficking, they were telling me they needed years, years of work, of intervention, of support, to really be able to stand up again after 15, 17 years of being held like slave and being trafficked by others. So I think on violence, we need to think big, we need to think long term, and not only short term, because otherwise we will be helping, and of course we need to do all the other things, engage men and so on, but we need to change the way we're doing things, because we're not doing it right. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. I'm glad we had the opportunity to hear from the president again. I'm afraid we've run out of time and we'll need to close the official conversation. I'll hand over the program to Mama Shell to begin the closing.
I don't think I have words at the end of this session. I have to say and to confess I'm overwhelmed. And I would like to suggest, maybe in a selfish way, that this debate should continue. I don't think I have the strength and the courage to say thank you and let's go. I think we need to regroup. So I want to thank you all for having come today, for having, at least from my perspective, for having given me an opportunity to listen. And I think I will be talking to you all and to see how we continue these discussions, most probably with a different format, but we need to continue to talk, and not only for talking, but to see what are we doing? What are we doing? But Michelle, thank you so much. I don't think really we can thank you enough. I don't think we can thank you enough. The day yesterday and today, for those of us who had the privilege of listening to you, have been days of very profound reflection, and days of asking ourselves very hard questions. And so I just want you to know that your coming to South Africa has touched in a very profound way those who had opportunity to listen to you. We do have lessons. We have taken notes. But we do have what I would call very deep, in Portuguese I would say, inquietações. I mean, we are just disturbed. But that's a positive kind of being disturbed with ourselves. So we have to thank you for having really succeeded in shaking us and taking us out of our comfort zones. And so we are hoping we will have an opportunity to engage with you, of course, in a different formats as well, to engage with you, and we welcome some of the suggestions which were made for us to continue the debate from that corner of the world. And to thank you, my brilliant minds, I'm so really proud of you. You organized this debate in a way which has matched very, very well with the debate which Michelle had started with us, to leave us with that sense of discomfort with ourselves. So I want to say thank you. This discomfort is welcome. It's needed. And as a university, as a social activist, I'm very shy to say this because there are those who are real social activists, but I'm part of it anyway. So as social activists, as university, and in different positions, but also simply as a woman, at the end, as a woman, I take these celebrations of 2014, Women's Day, Nelson Mandela annual lecture, as a moment of a turning point in lots of reflection. So thank you so much. Prof, thank you for having us. And again, I would like to thank many of our researchers, or many of our young minds who are trying to understand a lot of who we are and where we are, where we are going. To all of you, keep it up. And thank you so much. You make this institution very, very proud. And at the end of the day, I wanted also to thank the different groups of our mamas who have been working with us, or we have been working with you. It's much better. And we thank you mostly for sharing your lives with us. And we know in many aspects we have been failing you, but at least there is an attempt to connect. There is an attempt not to ignore what is happening around our own space and try to connect. And in that sense, we want to thank you so much also for having come here and share with us. I want to tell me again your name, my young lady. Yes. Zetu. I want to thank you especially. The standing ovation which you had here, and I was sitting there, and I was feeling like, oh my God, where have I been, and what have I been doing? And thank you. You made this. And as I said, this conversation cannot end here. It cannot. How it is going to continue, I do not know. But to all of you, thank you, thank you, thank you, and thank you very much.
Let's give Ma Michelle a round of applause for hosting the event. To give the final close, I will call on the Chief Executive of the Nelson Mandela Foundation, Mr. Sello Hatang.
Thank you very much, honored guests. I know that you were ready to leave.
And Madam President, thank you very much. I know that you have to leave. President Bachelet, Ma'am Michelle, Professor Ndebele and fellow trustees, VC Max Prize, honorable panelists, Professor Bennett, and our facilitator, anyone who can stop the president to say you've got 2 seconds is very powerful. So you did a stunning job and we thank you. We say to the president, gracias again. The last 2 days have been enlightening to us due to your contribution. So thank you very much again, and we can never thank you enough. This year marks the 50th anniversary of the sentencing to life imprisonment of Nelson Mandela and his comrades at the end of the Rivonia trial. It also marks the 50th anniversary of Madiba and his fellow comrades' arrival here in the Cape as citizens for 27 years. Of course, we are also marking the 20th anniversary of our democracy. For us, it is a moment of both somber reflection and quiet celebration. On the one hand, we remember that the Rivonia trial marked the beginning of a terrible era in South Africa's history. The apartheid state was at its pomp. The security apparatus moved to new levels of brutality, and resistance was in tatters. After the Rivonia trial, it was clear that the struggle would be very long and terrible. On the other hand, we celebrate the resilience of the Rivonia generation of Nelson Mandela, Ahmed Kathrada, Walter Sisulu, Dennis Goldberg, Govan Mbeki, and all the other Rivonia trialists. And indeed, all of the generation of activists, so many detained, imprisoned, tortured, intimidated, hounded, and forced into exile. Some of that you went through. We remember. We will not forget. And I say quiet celebration as we have to be mindful of the work that remains to be done, something you've been telling us in the last 2 days. The work that Madam Bachelet tells us we must renew our commitment to do it all. There is much unfinished business in our country and in the world. There are so many new challenges, so many intractable problems. Nelson Mandela, Madiba warned us in 1994 that 1994 was the first step in a long and complex democratization journey. He alerted us to the fact that long walk never ends. Friends, his foundation is committed to that endless walk. We reach out to all of you to continue the work tirelessly to build democracy and realize freedom. And we salute those who support such endeavors. As we progress in actively addressing, reckoning with, and learning from our past, we are drawing deeply on the experience of those who went before us, our own forebears, our ancestors, our founding fathers, and our founding mothers, those who lost their innocence. We are also learning to stop thinking of ourselves as exceptional. In fact, you've been saying that over and over and over. As a country with magical abilities and powers beyond the experiences of others. Yes, we did have Madiba magic, but we are an African country after all, with lots to learn from the rest of Africa. We are a nation of the South with much to learn from the South, which apartheid strove to separate us from. We are a modest global player with much to learn from the older players. The Nelson Mandela Foundation is committed to that, and we are saying to you, Zetu, we are saying it's important that we listen to what you said. And I think it's important that we also remind ourselves of what Madiba said when he said, the foundation has been laid, the building is in progress, with a new generation of leaders and a people that rolls up its sleeves in partnership for change. We can and shall build a country of our dreams. There is a lot more work to be done through wrestling with the basic principles of democracy and freedom, like equality, whether female, male, Catholic, Jewish, or Palestinian. Until we all experience these as individuals and as communities equally, our journey and responsibilities have not ended. And President Bachelet, you reminded us that we should never beat ourselves on the chest about what we have made in terms of, made possible in terms of numbers. And in fact, you said numbers don't count, but it's power and influence that counts. And I think it's important that we note, friends, that all of us have to walk that long journey that Madiba called us to do. For me, today represents a moment which I call Nelson Mandela and that generation of leadership. A moment all about connection, about solidarity, partnership, and endurance. The Chile-South Africa relations is a partnership which promises all these qualities. What President Bachelet told me earlier on is that there is power in solidarity because it gives those who feel oppressed hope. And hopefully we will continue to do that. Madiba was dreaming on Robben Island. Michelle Bachelet was dreaming while being tortured in prison. Friends, I know that you are still dreaming. We have this in common. We dream. And we work with those who dream to make those dreams possible. My message is simple, and it's to say, work with us. Let's work together. I think Madiba, if you want to again remind us what Madiba said, when he said, when a man has done what he considers to be his duty to his people and his country, he can rest in peace. I believe I've made that effort, and that is therefore why I will sleep for eternity. Madiba is sleeping now. Are we up for making that effort possible? Do we hear the call of duty, the call to be enraged? Are we together as we are enraged? We must continue to be enraged, to be outraged. I could hear the silent screams as Zetu was reminding us of what is inhuman in us. I could hear us say, stop, stop, don't tell us anymore, we've heard enough. I could hear all of us in that silence say, we don't want to hear anymore, but we need to be reminded. So I'd like to say to the UCT and all the others who are involved with this initiative, Africa Gender Institute, and the donors who made it possible, we thank you. To the Nelson Mandela Foundation and all of us, I say, we have a duty. Nelson Mandela called us all to dream. He called us on all of us to walk that long walk. May we continue to walk.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you for staying longer than perhaps you'd expected to, but I myself could have stayed even longer. I need to say to the Chileans, I'm very sorry that we have stopped your plane. It's not taking you away. We have this conversation that we need to continue. If I've been unsuccessful in my activism, then let me wish you a safe journey back. Please come back to us. Please continue this conversation in person, in voice, in every other way. Thank you to Mama Shell for inspiring us to remember what it is that matters in relation to both outrage and self-responsibility, to Yaliwe, to Mbuyiselo, to Nongoniso, to Zetu, to all the people who spoke from the floor and who perhaps might have wanted to speak had we had more time. I think we have been given a call to take this forward with you. The African Gender Institute would be extremely proud to be part of that. We will think of ways to do that. But may I now invite the platform party to leave and invite the rest of us perhaps to sit while they leave. There is actually, I was told the plane was going at 2. Whoa. Please can we just clap them out as they leave.